This video is going to be especially good for anyone that wants to learn more about AWS, more about the solution architect role, or learn more about the internship. So if you're one of those, stay tuned for this. Welcome to the third episode of What Does It Mean to Be a Solutions Architect Intern at AWS. In this episode, we're going to go through a deep dive conversation with my boss, Laura Hyatt, who's going to just talk about AWS, the internship, and the role. This is all information that I really wish I would have known before I joined the internship. So I hope you guys enjoy this. See you guys. Hope you guys enjoy it.
Hi everyone, my name's Laura Hyatt. I am an SA in the UK public sector team and specifically look after our education customers. And this year I am managing the interns.
What's your favourite part of AWS?
I really like the diversity of just the amount of stuff that we can do. Like obviously we've got our day job helping our customers, but I also get involved in evangelism, public speaking.
Please welcome with a very warm round of applause, Dan and Laura and Car Hacking Back to the Future 1970 style part two.
Managing you guys. Yeah. I just love the range of things you can get involved with.
What's your favourite part of the job so far?
Oh, good question. I think learning so much. Like even though I came in obviously having done AWS before, I have learned so much more than I possibly could have imagined. The upskill is just unbelievable.
What's the best way to pass the interview? What's the best tip to pass an Amazon interview?
You have to know the leadership principles. Is this in my face, like a moustache? You have to know the leadership principles, like you really, really do. They are everything in Amazon. They are ingrained in everything we do. And so the whole point of the interview is to see if you're a cultural fit. You obviously do a phone screen to see if you're technically capable, but then the loops, as they're called, because you do, depending on what level you come at, you usually do about five, like back-to-back sort of face-to-face interviews, is all to see if you're a cultural fit, and it's all based off our leadership principles. So understand the leadership principles and how your experience basically matches those leadership principles and showcases that you embody those principles. Come to you from outside the office on a very windy day.
What's the best part? Who's your favourite intern?
Okay, so what are the certifications that are available and what are the expectations?
So there are 12 certifications that AWS currently offer. In terms of like expectations, if you join as an SA, if you haven't got any previous certifications, like you don't need the certifications to come in with, but you do obviously need AWS experience. Within 3 months, you're expected to get the practitioner. Within 6 months, the SA associate, and then with 18 months, the SA professional. Obviously, you've already got those, great. And obviously, the more you get, the better. But they're kind of like the milestones you have to have coming in as an SA.
Where are all the SAs based?
We're kind of like spread out all over the place. So there are two AWS offices. There's one here where we are in Holborn, and there's also one in Manchester. But we're actually based virtually, technically. So my office is one house, technically on paper. And it's because we serve customers all over the UK. So the way it kind of works is that we are, I guess, our customers are kind of based geographically to where our houses are, because it doesn't make sense for us to hire only people in London when we have customers in Scotland, in Northern Ireland, in Manchester. So you can kind of be based anywhere, depending on obviously what customers we're looking to kind of serve, essentially.
So what kind of clients do you deal with?
So all of my customers are education-based, so I look after universities, edtechs, and researchers. I actually didn't come from an education background. I came actually from a finance, so I was in investment banking before I came to this job. But I actually find education really, really interesting. At first, I'll be honest, I was a bit like, oh, do I want to go speak to education customers? Like, it's not something I've had any background in. But I find it really, really interesting because we actually speak to the researchers themselves, professors, rather than, we do speak to IT people, but it tends to more be actually at the research level. And so I have the most amazing conversations. Like I've spoken, you know, with people who are working, you know, oncology, so cancer research, to talk about satellites, to robotics, climate change. I actually have the most interesting conversations, and I wouldn't change it for the world.
So where has your job taken you?
So obviously pre-COVID, you know, obviously I'm moving around.
Just changing the background scene.
Obviously, that was a transition. Pre-COVID, I got to travel a lot with this job. As much as my customers are UK-based, and I was traveling all over the country, because I do a lot, like I mentioned before, with AWS, you can kind of do lots of diverse things with this job. I got to go kind of all over the world, from America into Europe, and I had lots of other trips planned. Sadly, kind of COVID filled that. But you get to kind of travel a lot if you're doing like public speaking or doing demos. If you're kind of like a specialist in a particular area, so mine is IoT, then you can keep up with customers that are not UK based. So I was involved to do stuff in Europe, and I've actually got some. I've actually got some trips planned coming up for this fall in Europe, so doing like a road trip around Europe with the Sweet Machine demo that I did. So a partner of ours wants to take it on some conferences across like the Nordics, so I get to do that. So you get to do lots of travelling with AWS, which is pretty cool.
Awesome. So Laura, how technical do you need to be for the role?
You do need to be technical in the sense of, I suppose, two-pronged really, like understanding kind of the fundamentals of computing and then obviously AWS. I'd probably say the fundamental is what you need to come with, and the AWS can be taught. We have people that join with no AWS background, but obviously more technical in other areas. The reason why you need to kind of come with that fundamentals is because AWS is complicated, like let's not kid ourselves. So you need to kind of show that you have the capacity to learn, and we're here to like, we can teach you, like AWS can be taught, but you need to be able to have that capacity to learn.
So what kind of resources do you have during the internship or during your role to become more technical?
So during the internship, I can obviously speak for my program internship, I suppose, because every internship is slightly different. It is based on kind of what your manager sets in a way. So I devised basically a program. So you are expected to pass the SA Associate exam. And the way that I've kind of laid it out is that it's over 7 weeks, and I've kind of broken up the topics you need to learn about, do some labs, then we do like a, I guess, a revision, not a lesson, but at the end of every week, and kind of laid that out. And then I'm also sort of hosting these like 101 sessions on different topics every week, but also it's kind of up to you to also go away and learn the material. We're here and all the essays, and you've got the most clever people you'll possibly come across at your disposal. I hope you don't dispose of them, but it's very much, we're looking for self-starters. AWS is a self-starting job and that kind of mindset. No one's going to spoon feed what you need to know, so that's the type of person that we're looking for. But you've got every resource here, and people who are literally experts in those fields, like I'm talking like PhDs and multiple PhDs, and people who've created, you know, the languages and frameworks. And the thing is with AWS, like everyone is super friendly. Like go and speak to them, just drop a message on Slack and say, hey, like I'm really interested in what you've done, can I have a one-to-one? And I can guarantee like 99% of people will say yes.
So you've touched on a bit about networking. What does networking look like apart from dropping a message on Slack, and how often do you think you meet someone new?
So obviously kind of like, I get that it's really difficult at the moment with everyone being virtual. Like I would probably say I really enjoy networking, and I'm like always talking to people, and I found it hard doing it virtual, so we'll say it's a bit more difficult, but in a normal world, I'd say it's kind of hard to define, but it's very much just speaking to people. So what I did, so like at an event, for example, I could talk about my first week. So my very first week was actually at a tech conference, that was an AWS like internal tech conference. And what I did was I made sure every lunchtime there was like big tables, I made to just go and sit on a random table with just some random people and just say hi, introduce myself, and just talk about what they were doing. And there's actually people that I met there that now I speak to and I've had opportunities because of those connections. And then in the office, I will just go sit. Now it's a bit different because I've been here longer. I've kind of like chosen my desk, but it used to be that I would just pop around desk to desk because it's hot desking, just so I could meet new people. A little tip as well, if you're kind of like new to an office, sit on the aisle. I find that people tend to want to sit in a corner or by the window. I actually chose to sit literally in the aisle right near where like the sort of copier and the kind of like we've got these IT vending machines. I sat right by them because it means people walk past and often stop at those, and then I could just strike a conversation if it came about, like and just things like that. And I think also what's really important to also network with the people in like the building and services. So I always try and make friends with like security and building management and people like that, because it might sound like they're not going to be useful. Super useful, I can't even tell you. So I had a project to basically install a deep racer into the office, like a permanent deep racer tracker on our floor. And it wasn't the most simple thing, but because I'd already made friends with building management, I was able to kind of get them on my side to kind of like be like, come on, let's get this done. Yeah, so I'd probably say in terms of interesting slash like useful, and just how getting to know people sometimes pays off like long term. So I remember being, before I had this job, going to one of the AWS summits. So I was going to those summits before I even worked in AWS, but I knew that I wanted to go into that field, whether at the time I didn't even think I would ever work for AWS, but at least in that capacity. And I remember going to one of the conferences and going to the IoT stand and chatting to the IoT prototype SA. And we ended up swapping details. We took this like really, you know, casual chat about kind of like things I was working on, he was working on. And he ended up messaging me, and we were back and forth for a while, even before I, you know, worked in sort of this field. And then basically, like when I came here, I ran into him, and because he remembered, and we'd obviously had that conversation like years prior, he ended up becoming my mentor when I was looking to move sort of into the IoT space. And we have these things called TFCs, technical field communities. So they're like for generalist SAs. If you want to specialize in something, you can join basically a community for a particular kind of line of services. Mine is IoT, and he ended up becoming my IoT mentor, and he then introduced me to other people and introduced me to other opportunities, and I got to work on IoT projects outside of my sector. So it's kind of one of those things where like you never really know who you're gonna meet and where, but also just kind of like grab the opportunity. Like I was at a conference and I was like, am I gonna go talk to this like at the time I'd made a few little home demos in sort of IoT, and I'm talking to literally like a person whose job is to make IoT demos, like prototypes. But at the end of the day, just take a shot essentially. I'm not there to be like, oh my god, I'm an expert. I was just like, hey, I'm interested, can you talk about what you do? And then that's just paid off.
How does the role differ from a software engineer and a solution architect?
So a software engineer, at least in AWS, and I can speak with that because I will say a solutions architect is quite a broad role. It does differ from company to company. And actually, even I have like friends who are solutions architects by title, but we don't do really the same thing. So in AWS, a software engineer will, it depends if you're what you could be a software engineer internally and build part of the product team. So you might be working, say, in the EC2 team, and it's your job to like build components of the actual service of EC2, or I don't know, SageMaker or whatever kind of, and it's a lot more, I suppose, what you think of as like in tech, like your programming, and that's something. Whereas a solutions architect is a kind of hybrid between, is customer facing, which software engineers tend not to be, and it's like a hybrid between, it's hard to explain in the sense of, we're the technical advisor to a customer, so we need to be obviously very technical, but at the same time we're coming up with, as the name suggests, solutions for a customer. And so we're kind of thinking more almost like the art of the possible. So where a software engineer has a set of requirements from, say, a customer, or could be internal, external customer, and they're like, we want to build X, here's the requirements, and you need to go build that. A customer will say, I have a problem, how can I use AWS to solve this problem? And so I find it a really creative role, because a customer often doesn't really know what they want. They just know an outcome or a problem that they're having, or an outcome they want or a problem that they have. And it's our job to basically, along with them, to tease out as well what they really want, how best to kind of empower their business, and then design the architecture. Also to note, I suppose, on some of the technical kind of components in AWS, a solutions architect doesn't build anything in production for a customer. So any kind of coding and building will always be done as like an MVP, POC, whatever you want to call it. And then we can obviously give the architecture to a customer, but we don't touch anything production for a customer.
Hey guys, thank you for watching this episode. If you have any other questions about the internship, about the SA role, or just about AWS, make sure to drop them down in the comments and we'll definitely answer all of them. See you guys in the next one. Bye bye.